Many of you study computer science, and you probably haven't taken a linguistics course. That's fine. But this is a course about language. So we'll sometimes need to talk about things that are linguistic terms. You probably know some, or maybe even most of these ideas, but there might be some nuance to the terms that you might not have thought about before. So, just like how we'll discuss programming but won't teach you how to program, what we're going to talk about here is not a replacement for a linguistics course. You should still probably take a linguistics course, since they're a whole lot of fun. So first, let's take a look at the building blocks of language, words. But linguistics actually has lots of different words for words, and parts of words. We'll talk about both meaning and sound. Let's start with the meaning side and talk about a word called morpheme. So a morpheme is the smallest unit of a word that has independent meaning. So the un in uneatable means that something is not eatable, uneatable. And what is a morpheme might not be obvious to everyone. If you look at the word garlic, you might think that it itself is a morpheme. You can't divide this funny-looking seasoning any further. But if you dig in a little bit deeper, you can see that it's made up of something that's spear-shaped, a gar. And these gars actually look a lot like leeks, because gar means spear-shaped, and it's a leek, or a bundle of edible leaf sheaths. So you can unpeel garlic. Let's now take a look at phonemes. A phoneme is the smallest unit of a word that can change the meaning of a word. So for example, if you change the ah sound in the name Paul to I, it changes the meaning. Paul becomes pill. As you can see, there isn't a one-to-one correspondence between letters and phonemes. Well, morphemes and phonemes are parts of words. Let's move to talking about words themselves. In natural language processing, we sometimes avoid saying the word when it's confusing. But despite best intentions, we do say it a lot because, hey, it's sometimes the right word for word. But when it's confusing, we sometimes say something else. One reason that we need more ways to refer to a word is that there are many different ways to refer to the same concept. These variations are called lexemes. Lexis is the Greek word for word. And the root form of each of these lexemes is a lemma. And a single word on a page is called a token. But the generic term of that string, which you might find many times on a single page, is called a type. You might ask, what's the difference between a lemma and a type? A type is a string. Garlics, garlic, and garlicky are all different types, but these types share a connection. They're all lexemes of one lemma. And that lemma is an assumed root form that may never actually be written down. But in this case, it's actually a type, garlic. So instead of using all of these different things that we might casually call word, we can actually reduce this into something more precise. And when we strive for precision in this class, this is the way that we'll talk. The type garlicky, which refers to this abstract string, is a lexeme of the lemma garlic. And in this document, there are four tokens that have the garlic lemma and one that is the garlicky type. Jordan from the future here. One thing that I put on the slides but forgot to talk about is the concept of a minimal pair. So Paul and pill represent a minimal pair. You change one phoneme and you have a different word. We'll use the concept of minimal pairs in trying to show examples. What's the minimal change that you can make
that would affect some difference.
So those are words. How do words fit together? This is called syntax, and we're going to talk about this a lot in this class, but not for a little bit. So to tide you over until then, let's talk about some of the words associated with the concepts of syntax, and we'll get into the details later. So one thing that you might remember from junior high school are parts of speech. A part of speech divides how words function. Nouns are things you can touch, verbs are things you can do, prepositions show relationships, conjunctions put words together. You don't need to memorize particular parts of speech because, one, you probably already know them, and two, the exact set of parts of speech change from language to language or from application to application. There's been some recent work trying to unify these in something called universal dependencies that we'll talk about later in the class, but nobody agrees enough about parts of speech to make it worthwhile for you to memorize a particular set of parts of speech. So we'll just use abstract terms that you probably remember from junior high school. But the way words fit together is more than about individual words. This is a syntax tree. It shows how the words fit together. Again, we'll talk about the details later, but this is a sneak peek. The whole sentence is, John hit the ball. And the syntax tree shows the part of speech of the word ball. It's a noun. And there are some subparts of the sentence that it's often useful to be able to talk about. So, for example, we may talk about a noun phrase like the ball. And these phrases are all of the words that go with a particular part of speech. This could be pretty long. The red ball with the white spots, or the red ball with the white spots that Jack threw. We'll talk about this in a little bit. One of the defining properties of language is that it's hierarchical and infinitely recursive, and so you can have phrases within phrases. And the rest of the tree we'll leave shrouded in mystery, and we'll talk about that later. One of the tricky things about talking about language is that we all have some intuition about language already. And this is because we all speak at least English in this class. And we might come to this class with a lot of baggage when we talk about English or another language. Because we learned our language in different ways and different times and at different places, I may not refer to things in the way that you're used to. So if I say something that's confusing or use a word limit or morpheme that's unfamiliar to you, make sure you say something because, hey, this is a class about language and it'll be an interesting discussion. And otherwise, if you don't do this, words won't do what they're meant to do, convey meaning. And that would be totally against the spirit of learning about natural language processing. If you want to see more videos like this, check the video description for the course that comes from the link down below. You can then see the context and the correct order for watching these videos. YouTube will gleefully show you stuff in the wrong order. If you want other people to see this video, provide a big gradient to the recommendation algorithm by clicking the like and subscribe button down below.